Center for Online Professional Education and was co-director of the Northeast and Islands Regional Education Lab. He was also a faculty member at the Harvard Graduate School of Education and education chair of the Harvard EDC Leadership and the New Technologies Institutes. And on a personal level, I've had the pleasure of working with Glenn, both with him and under his supervision on a couple of projects, and he's definitely one of the best people I know.
Tamani mentioned I also have the pleasure of being on her dissertation committee. She's that close, and she's done a really good job. So it's a pleasure to be here. I've long known about the school. I've visited several times. I've worked closely with Melissa and Ross, and it's just delightful to be here. And as the room calls for and my nature calls for, this will be quite an informal setting. I brought some slides and examples I'll try to show, but feel free to interrupt, ask questions, direct me what's useful. I don't really have a whole lot of background on kind of where you are and what you're looking for, so I kind of took my best guess, and we'll move forward. So I'll start off with some background stuff, kind of fill in a little more of the history and some idea of what we're doing. I was asked to talk about the Friday Institute's model of professional learning. We don't have a model. We have some guiding principles we work by, and then we design according to the intended audience, intended content, the context, the blend of face-to-face, online, lots of parameters. So I'm not here to say here's a way of doing it, but I can talk a little bit about what we do, some of what we've learned. I threw in a little bit about what I did even before I came here and what we learned, because actually that has some connections to Melissa from her Learn NC days, and I was thinking about what do we know that I could share with you. And then we'll break, we'll have you guys do some table discussion, and then with what time's left, I'll talk a little bit more specifically about the MOOCs for Educators work, because that's an example of how we take our design principles and try to apply them with a really new context of wide-scale online learning, and happens to be the basis for Tamar's dissertation, too, so she can fill in some more of what we're doing. That work? Okay. People know the Friday Institute? We're over at NC State University. We have a very cool building. We do run lots of conferences and various things. Come visit. And very quickly, we have official mission statements and all that, but really our goal, our reason for living and working, or at least working, is to help create the next generation education system with a focus on pre-college education. That's the gist of it, and we've got lots of good people doing cool things around that. Tamar mentioned, I have to update that because we finished the digital learning plan, so I was directing it. But we had a large contract and about 2 years of work to develop what should have been called the digital age learning plan, because it's not really about the technology, it's about teaching and learning. But we've put together with a lot of work with school districts and working groups and advisory boards and everything else, a plan which really hopefully will guide some of the state's work around updating the system to digital age teaching and learning, looking at everything from the infrastructure to the professional learning to the state policies. So that's taken up a lot of time recently. And I knew we were gonna miss the edge. Should I dare touch it and try to adjust this? Just a tiny bit. We spent a long time trying to get the projector lined up. There we go. And I won't go into detail, just, you know, this table, well, there's a two-sided table that talks about traditional learning versus digital age learning. This is just the digital age side. But so when we talk about this, oh, it's got the wavy lines again. People okay? You getting seasick from that? It's okay? Things like anytime, anywhere learning, personalized learning, competency-based learning, things I'm sure most of you are familiar with. And we emphasize that the plan is about how we do those kinds of things in the school, enabled and enhanced by technology. It's not just about giving out devices and setting up network infrastructure. Just very quickly, and I'll make a few comments. I wish it's bothering me, even if it's not bothering you. Or maybe I'm looking at it from the side. We'll stop there. Just a few examples and a couple of notes of things we've learned. Before coming here, this is actually on the next slide, while at EDC, back in 1997, I get older each time I do this, we started a program called E-Learning for Educators, which was to help districts and states develop capacity to do online professional learning. back in 97 when we started this, you know, I remember we ran an institute at Harvard, a group of us, and we actually created a website for it. And people came in and we took a digital picture of them. And by the end of the first day, everybody's picture and bio was up on this website. And it was an amazing thing in 1997. And now your typical second grade class can do that, right? So it's come a long way. But the idea here was to help groups around the country develop that capacity to first run online courses for educators and then develop them. That morphed into something called e-learning for educators, which was a very large federal grant to spread that to states around the country. North Carolina was one of the late states to join in, and it was centered at LearnNC. And I guess Ross did a great job as the point person on that. And part of the learning experience there, these were small cohort, asynchronous, run over period of weeks with strong facilitation. And we had a lot of research around this, but one of the lessons there was you really can do a lot online. Educators can learn about, can share ideas, can communicate well online. Some people didn't like to work that way. Some people preferred that to face-to-face. Some liked it be a blend. But the work over there convinced me that there really was a lot of potential in online learning for educators. And we had a strong belief that I maintain to this day that it's very important we give educators an opportunity to learn in the ways we're asking them to teach. And having folks experience online learning as students first seemed to be a great entry point into having them use online technologies in teaching. The other thing is, as people would go through a course we developed, similar to LearnNC one, on designing online courses, and we often got feedback, well, this really made us rethink how we did things in face-to-face professional development. It was a new lens. It's kind of like when you learn a foreign language, you really learn more about English. It felt like that kind of thing. So I think applying new technologies, King Prince has potential and can loop back to influence on more traditional approaches. And then, of course, it's the blend of the two where the most power is. When I came here, we quickly got involved in the state's early one-to-one pilots. This was 2007. And we began to work with the Golden Leaf Foundation that funds a lot of the Tier 1 and Tier 2 districts, the economically distressed districts. It's the tobacco settlement money trying to help the districts that have been economically damaged. And a lot of it's actually county proposals. A lot of the counties send in education proposals around bringing digital learning to their classrooms. So we've done professional development for teachers and administrators really throughout the state, and really have gotten, I think, a much deeper understanding of the variety of school contexts. And so much of the thinking at the federal level, sometimes at the state level, is really urban district oriented. And Halifax and Northampton and Weldon City and Wake County and Charlotte Mech are totally different worlds. And learning to think about how do you address the different needs, what are the roles of different approaches, what are the expectations, the backgrounds of the teacher, and really the school culture, and what are the levers of change in different places as you do professional growth. So that's one of the lessons that's come out of that. We also developed a program with NCPAPA. You all know that acronym? It's a great acronym. North Carolina Principal and Assistant Principals Association. Specifically for principals on preparing them to be leaders of digital learning transitions in their schools. And one lesson there is the role of school leaders has really changed. We're talking about new kinds of ways of communicating with your community, new kinds of organizing, new demands, principals understanding how to work with the technology people, understanding the nature of distributed leadership, because no one person can do all the things they're expected to do, the use of new data systems, responding to new evaluations, teacher evaluations. So I've learned a lot about the incredible demands on school leaders, but that we also know from lots of research around the country, things won't change unless there's a school leader leading and supporting the change. And you know, we teach teachers about doing project-based learning and all kinds of cool things that I'm sure many of you do. And the principal comes in to observe the classroom and wants to know, why is it so noisy? You've lost, right? Or is it insisting on very traditional evaluations as the one and only thing? So lots of important work there. That program, as in many of our programs for school and district leaders, is a blended program. It expands over a school year. During the school year, there are 6 face-to-face meetings that are typically, the original program, those were about a day and a half each. So there's a lot of intensive time together, reflecting the lesson that educators love to have time together with people in similar roles, and there's tremendous learning from within the community. Between those 6 sessions, which is spaced out a month or 6 weeks or 2 months, there are online activities that are facilitated. So the principals are asked to go back and do things like conduct focus groups with their teachers and students and parents, analyze their school data, review their digital learning plan and how it intersects with the other plans they have. So things that are very much problems of practice, which is a theme you'll hear in a lot of our work. How do we engage people in their professional learning programs in what are genuine problems of practice that really serve their own needs? How do we blend intensive days with big groups face-to-face together, working together, learning from each other, with continuing that work online and connecting it with their day-to-day life in the school? Another one of the themes of our work, these are probably on a later slide, but is that successful professional growth has to be job embedded. It's not something you do for a couple of days at the beginning of the year. It's got to be ongoing and in the context of teaching and learning. Someone calling me? I don't know. We similarly have a superintendent's program with the North Carolina Association of School Administrators. Superintendents are an interesting group to work with, but we won't go into those stories. But those, I think, really help us think about where different people are, what they're comfortable with. It is so much easier and more fun to engage teachers like you folks on, let's do a hands-on activity, let's try something, let's just play with this and see what it is. Boy, those superintendents resist that kind of work. So adapting the activities to the audience becomes a very big thing. And they are less engaged online. We do some online exchanges, but some of them are big on like Twitter and quick things, but they have so little time and they don't live online. But what we actually prefer is what we're doing in the next one is a district leadership program. We've started this with this CCRESA, the Central Carolina Regional Education Service Agency, which brought together the 14 districts in this region. And this is over 3 sessions. The first one's 2 days and 1 day sessions. We bring together leadership teams. So in most cases we have a superintendent, associate superintendent for curriculum instruction, HR people, technology people, and really have them work on analyzing where they are, where they want to go, and what that plan will look like. So again, it reflects some of the same principles, real problems of practice, folks working in collaboration, working on their own context rather than some mystical context we made up. But we really, you know, if we had to pick one of these 3, we would really focus here. We see tremendous power of bringing cross-role teams together to work together and share the different perspectives on this work. This is all around digital learning, planning kinds of things. There's lots of value in the role-like work, but the teamwork really is important. Then we have a whole nother different group where the principals play it very differently. These are the instructional tech coordinators, library media specialists, instructional coaches. They come together several times a year, and then even if we didn't do anything online, they'd all be online all the time anyway, because they're those kinds of people, and they love sharing the newest tools and trying out everything, and they are the most energetic, engaged group we work with. And this to us is a big theme. We keep, in the digital learning plan, we keep trying to convince everybody, and if you know any legislators, please help, that it's great. We got the networking infrastructure set up, districts are buying devices, but it really is about preparing the education workforce, which in this state is 100,000 people, for new ways of teaching and learning. And our best success there will be if we've got principals ready to support it, and we have instructional tech facilitators or coaches in the school who can do the modeling, co-teaching, providing resources, support the teachers on an in-school, day-to-day, ongoing basis. So it's building more of that capacity is what we're doing here. And then the MOOCs for educators I'll come back to. So I can talk about all of that endlessly. I'll try not to today, but that gives you a quick run through. I'll just say a couple of things here because I put this on. I don't know, I was thinking last night, but I go back, my first work in professional learning with a colleague. We used to pack up our car with a couple of devices and take them out. And we had built some boxes that enabled us to hook them up to a big TV screen. And the devices were things like Apple II and TRS-80 and Atari 400 and even PET, Commodore PET computers. I see some of you smiling because you used those when you were kids, and some of you know what the hell I'm talking about. But it was great fun. This was out in California. And one of the things I learned there is at the beginning, you know, we were being brought in by San Mateo and Santa Clara County Departments of Education. And it was an invitational thing. It's like the teachers who are interested, hey, come and we'll, you know, show you some stuff and do some cool things. And that then, a year or two later, it became a requirement for all teachers. And you've probably seen the thing about, you know, early innovators or the, and then the settlers who will follow the innovators but are interested, and then the resistors. Boy, that's a true thing in many schools and many districts. And how you work with a group that's very engaged in, well, let's try this new stuff. Let's take some risks. Let's see what our students do. You know, I'm perfectly comfortable being up there in front of my students and trying something, telling them, this is new. I don't know how this works. You guys figure it out and tell me. Versus those who say, I need to control the classroom and I know exactly what's going to happen. So adapting the professional learning opportunities to where people are, and there's all kinds of change models and things many of you are familiar with, but that really hit home. Work with, the, when I was at EDC, we were, anybody, I don't have the math people here, anybody remember the geometric supposer? It came before Geometer Sketchpad. It was one of the first very interactive visual math things, and then we did other work with IBM and a lot of work in trying to help teachers think about what do these new tools really mean in the classroom, and discovered quickly it's not about new tools. We were creating things that were bringing, in these cases, dynamic, interactive, exploratory things into math class, right? Things that had kids posing their own problems, right? Exploring things in different ways, kids discussing the mathematics, things solving math problems in different ways, some very algorithmically, some visually, some more manipulatively. And we realized, or I realized, I was young and naive, that this wasn't about the technology. This was really about fundamentals of teaching and learning. And we'd work with some teachers who always wanted to make mathematics interactive and engaging and dynamic. And they were like waiting their entire teaching lives for these tools to come along so they could do it. And there are others who were totally baffled by what we were talking about because they saw mathematics as something you learn, wrote algorithms, and you apply them to problems in a book. So again, this constant lesson of how professional growth works, really understanding the conceptual structures of the audience and how you can help bridge from where they are to what you're trying to advocate for. I put seeing and thinking mathematically. I led the development of an NSF-funded middle school math curriculum that was used in Durham, and maybe some of your math folks would know it. Anybody remember Everly Broadway? Did everybody know Everly, who's the math coordinator? It goes way back, I just put it up. We developed a cool math curriculum. It was followed the kinds of principles I talked about. It added a lot of more complex language to the curriculum. Had kids discussing things, describing how they did things, working in groups. And then we discovered when we got out to schools with it, well, it's kind of cool. And there are kids, some kids who really are grabbed by this and are excited to be doing mathematics in different ways. But there are other kids, and particularly the special needs kids, well, if a kid was an English language learner or had reading difficulties, having all this additional language and math could be a negative. And some of those kids, math was where they'd been successful previously, and here we were making it more complex for them. If kids had attention problems, having projects where they had to work sort of through multi-step things and the need for a lot of scaffolding, and we could go on through the list, but then began to realize, well, the special ed teachers were working with these kids, but they had a very traditional view of mathematics instruction. So we had NSF funding for a project that brought together math and special ed teachers and began to learn a lot about professional learning communities and the importance of teachers working together and things like action research and lesson study of really engaging teachers in the problems of teaching and learning from different perspectives. So we try to build that into some of our work. I'll just move on. I don't want to take too much time here. Let me break for a moment. I don't like to lecture too much, but you know, when you have an hour plus and a lot to say, you end up doing it. And you know, I'm a professor, it's what I've been trained to do. But let's take a little time and do some discussion at your tables So I get a little sense of where you are. I know you're thinking about, I guess, your own professional growth and how the school will support professional growth. Is that what this is really about? Oh, okay. Is that, is it about something else I should know about? Why are you guys here? You were too.
Yes.
What was that? Both your, for yourselves, for professional growth you'll deliver to others, for both, who knows? All right, we'll just talk. So what I'd like you to do, each of you, to think for a couple minutes and think about some professional growth experience that you've had that worked for you, that you view as this was a good example. And then not just describe what they did, but think about, well, what are the attributes? What made this good? You know, and it could be anything. Was, you know, they gave us really good food, or they took us somewhere, or it was about this content, or it worked in this way, or it did this, whatever it is. And discuss those for a bit, and then we'll just do a quick go-round, have each table kind of throw out one attribute that you'd like to see in good professional development, and see what we get from that. Is that clear enough? Go. We'll take 10 minutes or so to do this, and then we'll come back.
Best professional development.
Oh, really? Cool. Good. Okay, can I get people back? Hello, hello. I know we had different size groups, and if we had a bigger session, we'd do the whole process of recording these and organizing them, but I'm just going to do a quick round table, just each table shout out one, and then we'll go around a second time until we kind of feel like we're getting pretty redundant. Okay? So just kind of what makes professional development good for you? You guys got one? Okay, so the timing issues are very important. When is the right time? How much time? If it's a priority, there's time allocated to it. If it's not, it's squeezed in at the end of the day. Next table, you guys got one?
Remembering the pleasures of learning for its own sake.
Ah, very nice. Learning for its own sake. We're all educators. We're here because we enjoyed learning. We had a group in the back, yes? I'm sorry.
Discipline specific.
Content. Yes. Yes. That often has come out around technology. The vendors will come in, they'll sell you devices, and they'll say they're doing professional development, but they're really teaching you how to do devices. They're not teaching you, what does technology mean when you're teaching history versus biology versus mathematics versus English literature?
Not even that. I mean content.
Not
how do I implement it using technology?
Okay. Learning.
Learning something new.
Yes.
In our discipline.
Okay.
So.
Great. So yes. Your own learning, which is part of the joy of learning. Folks, we often use the TPAC model, technological, pedagogical, content knowledge, and how you need all three of those to teach effectively with technology, and certainly the content knowledge is something we all need to keep learning. One more in the back.
Yeah, I think we're all saying the same thing. Most effective professional development projects we concluded, Kyle and I, that we've ever participated in were those designed to develop teachers' levels of knowledge. We don't need more of the tech day, the how-to of education, the process of educating people, but more of what makes our courses so compelling, and that is knowledge of the area, refreshing our ideas, and recreating our excitement, igniting our excitement about what we're doing. That the U.S. government ever did. And the external review on that found that, yes, was enormously helpful. I got great reviews from the teachers. And of course, the
funding went away. Yes. Okay. But no, this is a great,
yeah, I think we're all kind
great of theme, experience as learners. And those who are great learners tend to be the best teachers. And those who are ongoing learners and have the joy of learning convey that to their students, which is probably more important than anything else. So those are great examples. Good. Going around, you guys?
A lot of our discussion was about content PD as well. But I think one thing we had in common was we often attended workshops that gave you time to use what you were learning in the professional development to create something that you could then take back to
mm-hmm.
the class.
Okay.
And get feedback on from the other participants.
Okay, so actually generating something of use that you can try out and that I think fits, you know, one of the themes I either mentioned or will, if when we talk about problems of practice and job-embedded learning, it means you come out of it with something you can try out with your students, you can bring back, you can share, you can get feedback. Great. Should we just, we'll go around the outside and then come into the inner loop. You guys got something?
We talked about the importance of getting to watch our peers work
mm-hmm.
and actually seeing from watching someone actively implement, trying to do things and getting feedback and ad hoc interactions between back, what happens when you get a small group of people together. Other things in terms of like high interest,
mm-hmm.
things that we're, you know, keeping things that you're interested in.
Okay.
Large for everybody doesn't necessarily help.
Right. Okay. So the first one is more sort of modeling, coaching, co-teaching kinds of experience with high interest. Great.
So we just talked about a similar topic about peers. And given that we do something that's a little bit different, it can be difficult to find people who do something, you know, quite similar to you in a similar
mm-hmm.
context. So Asian studies or whatever it is, or athletic director for a school that has a lot more diverse offerings than a typical high school. So those are the opportunities that we
okay.
enjoy problems from.
Opportunities were with colleagues. Again, another great point, and that's where from early on, I thought the online connections had some possibilities. Now, one of the interesting projects we did at EDC, we worked with the Department of Defense Education Agency on the schools there on the military bases around the world. And as they said, these are American kids, American teachers with an American curriculum, but there's not another school down the road. So if you have a calculus teacher there, they don't have another calculus teacher teaching that curriculum anywhere. And they were real eager to have teachers interacting online, so they were able to do that. It's probably preferable to do that face-to-face, but the online technologies gave us an alternative where that wasn't possible.
Some of the things we all had in common were that the participants were really invested, that they had chosen to be there, and they were really excited about being there. And also that also the participants could help steer the direction of the PD based on their own interests. We also talked about having a diversity of activities and a good camaraderie among participants
mm-hmm.
and a feel of community.
Yes, great. All important points. The first one reminds me of what I said about my early days when we started out with the innovators and then everybody's told they had to be there and the whole thing changed. And the idea of learning community and camaraderie is so important. I think in any professional development, but I think as educators, we're here because we like to work together and share ideas. You guys, so you plunged right into an active conversation?
Yeah, definitely, but so many of these are, I think the themes are strongly coming out here. One of the things we were talking about was the individual nature, or the individualized nature of content. And,
mm-hmm.
and having it really have direct application to
mm-hmm.
to our very three unique classrooms. And then just one other thing that sort of jumped out to me as we were talking about was exemplary experiences for a couple of us were built on things that really had nothing to do with our specific course content, but bringing skills that we had from other even areas of our lives, from counseling in Karen's case, or for me
mm-hmm.
a sales job that I had, into the classroom,
mm-hmm.
which is really a
nice.
A professional development experience
mm-hmm.
at some level, and probably being open to that too.
Yeah, great. I'll tell a personal example at the end that relate to that, but I'll hold it for the moment. You guys got one or two?
A lot of what we said was the same,
mm-hmm.
kind of to go along with at the end of the day, if we try to go to a conference or something during the school year, there's no substitutes, so
okay.
we're dumping on our colleagues, which
yes.
makes it harder to do that. So we sort of found summer things were much more useful.
Okay, so again,
because there's time
and flexibility, but also I'm hearing organizational structures that say this is important, and if there are good conferences during the school year, we'll make sure that you can go without just burdening your colleagues. Yeah, those are the kinds of things we work with the administrators. Let's see, we haven't been here yet.
We did think content was important, but we really enjoyed a bunch of PD experiences that we had over pedagogical things, and echoed the thoughts that we needed time and those experiences, for example, to create a rubric or to generate some new lesson plans and then be able to go try it out. So those experiences required us to be reflective about our teaching and know sort of what was going to fit in. The PD experience then filled that need, allowed us time to work on something, get some feedback, and then we were able to go right back in and implement it.
Okay, so some of the same consistencies of real problems of practice that you can implement and use, but you're bringing the pedagogical side to balance the content side, which I think is great. So if you're moving towards portfolio assessment or use of rubrics or competency-based assessment, there are things that are really pedagogical strategies as well as deep content. Good. That's a great set to start. Well, are there others that people would like to make sure they get to say? We can do another quick go-around. Hard to believe we got everything. We had a good set. This is the, you know, speak now or speak later. You can.
So,
yes, we've got one.
One other thing that came up in our group was that it's it occurs either for in one setting over a long period of time,
okay,
or multiple times,
mm-hmm,
kind of a long term focus,
okay,
and not just, you know, hour here and then that's the last time you.
Okay, not the flyby professional development doesn't work for you, is that okay? Yes, sir.
This morning I raised this in a different way, but it makes me wonder, as we celebrate things that we really like, and we are all here because we really like the things that we're doing, to push the technology further away, not because it's inconvenient or because we really don't want to know about it, but because it doesn't reinforce our values.
Mm-hmm.
Given the pace at which technology is impacting the children, are we continuing to push them further and further away from us? And so
yes,
even though this might not be something we want to learn,
mm-hmm,
the consequence of not wanting to,
okay,
learn this puts us in danger of becoming irrelevant. Not because what we have is,
right,
important, but because they don't,
okay,
care. And I wonder,
yes,
about that. I don't know what the data is.
Well, and yeah, I mean, I think that's a great point, and it's really helping all of us, and some of us have been around a long time. Some of you grew up more with technology, but to adjust to the changing times. And I do have another lecture I won't give, but talks about, I'm a cognitive and developmental psychologist background, and how different our kids' perspectives are. They think that all information is immediately available, right? They can communicate with anybody at any time. They have powerful tools. I mean, they have music tools that the greatest composers would have died for. They have animation tools that Walt Disney never could have imagined, that they have so much power in what they can do. There's a whole set of these that everything has intelligence. I mean, just, well, I guess I put my phone over there. And once in a while, you think about this magical device that got me here, that I carry in my pocket, that I tell it where I want to go, and now I can say it, and it tells me how to get there. I mean, that's bizarre. But our kids, that a device has that kind of intelligence, in quotes, and knowledge, and you know that you can search anything. So they really do have a different view of knowledge, of communication, of creativity, and we all need to deal with that. And that's part of why I think educators need to experience some of that. I think it's a very challenging transition for all of us, and I'm glad you raised that point.
For many of us, though, the opposite is true. We have access to greater technology than we do in the classroom because we don't have access to those tools here. So we're waiting for,
yes,
the facilities to catch up with our own understanding. I mean, for me, what you're saying, I understand all of that, and I feel,
yes,
like my technological context is at least on par with or greater than that of my students.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not a barrier,
yeah,
to my understanding.
Yes.
It's having access to,
yeah,
equipment,
yep,
to implement that technology.
Well, and I know my colleague Phil Emer, who's a parent of one of your students, has been working with your strategic plan. He's driving the technology infrastructure for all the schools in the state. And he's reported to me a little surprised that you guys weren't more advanced yet, but hopefully that's being resolved, and certainly we need to do that. So I think this blend of, you know, we've got deep content, we've got pedagogy, we've got catching up with the new ways in which things are done and what it really means for students to be a digital age learner and how we can be digital age educators, bringing all of that together are part of the challenges for all of us. Other things people would like to get in? Don't be shy. You don't seem like a shy group. Okay, that was good. Actually, it's interesting because I've done this activity with other groups. And the one difference, I mean, obviously, you're a unique school and you're a unique bunch of teachers. There was more emphasis here on deep disciplinary content than I usually hear. Otherwise, you pretty much overlap with other teachers. And I think that has something to do with who you are and where you're teaching and the students that you need to keep up with. And I've met some of your students. I actually had the pleasure of going to Beijing with the four students who won the science award, one of whom was from here. And I mean, these students blew my mind. I could never keep up with what they know about science. So I can understand how you have to keep refreshing and advancing your disciplinary knowledge when you have students like that. Many schools, of course, don't have students at quite that level. Yes?
Because we wish not simply to keep up. I mean, I think our students should keep up with us. I think we
Yes, of course.
Translate that to the classroom.
Yeah.
But I think we want them to aspire to
us. Yes, a better phrase. I know, I mean, you guys are in many ways more like a college faculty than a typical high school faculty. Yes, yes. Good. Okay, let me switch gears, and I'm cognizant of the time. I will try to go quickly. So as I said, usually we try to organize that, but I'll leave that, you know, when they open the bar, you guys can hang out and organize your thinking and all that. There's just a standard list we use. It gets dropped into proposal and all, but you'll see a number of things you said were already on this list. And there's, if you ever need this kind of list, there's research from Linda Darling-Hammond at Stanford and others, so that when we talk about any professional development we do, we come back to these kinds of things. Does it deepen subject matter, increase understanding of learning, and appreciation of students' needs? So I think that kind of says it's what the three tables in the back corner said all needs to be put together. That worked out pretty well. Centers around critical professional activities. Many of you said that in a number of ways. Builds on problems of practice that lead to reflection and professional discourse. And some of you talked about it's not just a quick drop-in. We've got to do something, we've got to create something, we've got to try it out. But this reflection, you then have to think about it when you talk about co-teaching and modeling. Those are all stimuli, and their value is when you really reflect on and learn from it, not just do those things. So those are very important, and allowing time for that is important. Provide opportunities for educators to learn in the ways they will be expected to teach. That theme of some of you, I'm sure, are quite sophisticated with the technologies, with new pedagogies, with collaborative learning, with, what do we call it? Student-centered learning. I almost said constructivist learning. I'm so old. I know we're not allowed to use terms like that anymore. So I think that's part of it. And is personalized to meet individual needs. It's funny, I always chuckle when I see someone lecturing on the importance of differentiating instruction for students, while not thinking, well, we need to do that for educators also. Cultivates a culture of collegiality. We all learn, it's a social action learning, and I think it's particularly true for educators, and is ongoing, intensive, and woven into professional work, kinds of points you were raising. So I think you've captured some, you have a research-based set of ideas that you came up at your table that if you needed them, we could give you a whole bunch of references if you're writing a grant proposal and you could turn them into official proposalese. But I think these are some of the kinds of things you've captured very well. I can make the slides available. I see some people try and take notes, but if you want these. So what I'd like to do in the remaining, we have about a half hour. We'll save a little time at the end for further discussion. So we've got about 20 minutes, so I'll have to move quickly. Given all that and those principles, one of the things we started on about 3 years ago, this whole talk started about MOOCs, massive online open courses. And as I said, I've had a lot of experience with different forms of professional development, particularly online learning. I thought, Well, there might be some potential here. We had always done small cohort-based facilitated kinds of things. Melissa's very familiar with those. What? Well, maybe there's something here about doing these at massive scale. So we always have the scale problem. Said there are 100,000 educators in the state. But I never thought it was going to solve the problems of dropouts and kids who weren't learning. But that maybe with educators who are self-motivated learners, who are highly literate, who like to work in community, maybe there's something here. So we formed something called MOOCs for Educators. Really is an experiment. We just started building one because that's what we do. We then got some funding from the Hewlett Foundation, the Oak Foundation, so we're getting support for this. And it really was about the theme of we're expecting so much of our educators with so many changes going on in curriculum and assessment and data and student demographics and technologies that we have this enormous national education workforce and state workforce. Lots of turnover, lots of new folks. We know there's tremendous dissatisfaction with the traditional models of professional learning. There's lots of data about that, the kinds of things, the drive-by, the hour at the end of the day, the one day in service is not something that educators say, those are great, that's all we need. And there's also, of course, in the broad world, lots of issues now about cost efficiency. We have almost no resources going into professional learning in this state, in the education branch. Call your representatives and complain about that. Very helpful. We're working on it. So lots of reasons we thought this is worth exploring. And the real question was, can MOOC-like approaches be adapted to address educators' needs, follow those principles of effective professional development, and provide something that's scalable and accessible and effective? And again, we also had the very rural communities, teachers of special areas where they don't have colleagues in mind. So we set out and exploring that. I won't take you through the history. I always wonder which had come first. Let me show you what one looks like, and then I'll go back and talk about the specific design principles of what we did there. And we lost Tamar, but this is the basis of her dissertation. So excuse me, let me sit down and see. Actually, I'll go back one slide. We've developed a set of these around digital learning, around mathematics, around learning differences, around disciplinary literacy. And I thought it'd be fun to show the one that Tamar's dissertation is based on, as long as everything works well. And I actually had this already open. Nope. What did I just do? Okay. So these are online sets of resources designed to be interactive. And this was and probably most of you aren't old enough to remember the old Mickey Rooney, Judy Garland movies where they'd say, come on gang, let's put on a play. This was kind of, come on gang, let's make a MOOC. We don't really know what it is, but it sounds kind of interesting. So we started with one on digital learning. We then moved on. So each of them has an overview, a set of goals for the course, deeper understanding of the content, investigating common students' misconceptions, analyze student thinking, address students' learning differences. The fractions one is built around a guide, practice guide for teaching fractions from the Institute for Education Sciences, the U.S. Department of Education. So it was a lot of research-grounded work. And typically, they range, but this one is 8 weeks of content. There's an opening introductory week. There were then 3 main weeks on 3 main approaches to teaching fractions at different levels. Each of those is 2 weeks. So there's time for people to try something in the classroom and reflect back, and then a final wrap-up week. If we stop doing that, please. I don't know why that is happening to me. Let me jump into one. What is going on here?
Did you already have it queued up on one of the tabs?
I just closed that. Let's see if that will work. I don't understand why it is not going to the lesson. Hang on a second. Sorry about this, but you know, when you give presentations, nothing ever works.
Technology
works quite right. It's very strange. This was working earlier. Are you coming? Well, this is, now that's, I had the tab for the main thing. Hang on, we'll get it. Well, let's see if I click on something else. Huh. Very strange. It was working earlier. Yep, what we're going to do is we're going to take the risk and close it out and start again and see where we end up. No, I was just trying to go to the actual actual MOOC. That should be it. Oh, that's not the right one, though. Huh. I have never seen, I've done these thousands of times and I've never seen this before. Let's try this. It is really like some.
Oh, they taught us how to use overhead projectors.
Let's go down to that one. Backup set of links. All right. All right, close enough. I will do this quickly and give you a sense of it. If it will work, if not, I will talk some more and show a YouTube. All right, there it goes. So just very quickly, I'd like to do this in more depth. So this is a traditional a sort of unit structure, and they vary, but there's an introduction. There'll be a little video. One of the things we've learned, we have lots of data, lots of analytics. People don't watch long videos, right? Our videos are limited to 5 minutes max. When we look at how long people spend, that's about it. When we survey people, they say, oh yeah, I love to watch a video when I'm sitting in the car waiting to pick my kid up after school. Or I put one on while waiting for the water to boil. And we've learned that these kinds of things, people can do a lot, but they do it in little segments of time. Yeah. That's how they use the web. And it's a very different design than we think of, you know, I'm a professor, I'm going to give an hour lecture. That doesn't work. So how to make things into nice little chunks where each one is worthwhile is part of it. And we try to keep the text short. We have an opening discussion, which here asks people, well, how do you teach about computing with fractions, which is a tricky thing to teach. This is for upper elementary school teachers. Generally, it's an area that's really a target of difficulty for them and their kids. And what are the big challenges? So we try to get people into it by sharing their own experiences and their own frustrations. We then had developed a series for this called What Would You Do Next?, which turned out to be very, very robust and interesting. And hoping this will all work. And I'd like to take a few minutes, even though we're short of time. I think this is worth showing. So these are short video clips. That start on their own. You might recognize that voice. That's Tamar. These were based on clinical interviews we did with kids about math problems. So we'd give a kid a math problem, and our folks in the room were not allowed to give them answers. They were only allowed to ask questions, trying to uncover the kid's thinking. We then stop it at a certain point, and the discussion is, what would you do next? What do you think this kid understands, doesn't understand? What would be the right next teaching step? Okay? And we found this is incredibly a good format for getting really engaged discussion. Our approach to MOOCs is it's about engagement. Somebody mentioned engagement. And about educators sharing their ideas is where the best learning is. So we look for what are the right types of stimuli for that to happen. Even though it's online, even though it's a large number of people, even though they've got no reason to be there other than they're interested. They can get some CEUs if they complete certain requirements. There's no college credit. There's no tuition. So let me just take a few minutes and show this, and then talk about
among nine people. So he begins by using one strategy and shifts to another.
Okay, sharing.
Consider the different approaches he takes as he works to solve the problem.
Sharing 50 among nine people. Let me.
Should each person get, so I think you should do 50 divided by 9.
Is that?
And you get.
You get that, okay?
45. had more volume before. He's asked what he would change. He's a little puzzled at this point. So he doesn't know what to do with that extra five at the bottom, which is not an atypical confusion for kids. I don't know what happened to Yvonne, but he was asked, what would you do with that extra five, right? Just the question, no instructions. So one of the reasons for this is we want to help teachers really look closely at students' thinking, not just about right and wrong answers. So we're trying to demonstrate this kind of way of looking closely at students. Says he'll do it a different way. Don't worry, I won't make you go through the whole, so you get to skip ahead, right? 50 lines, 9 circles, starts dividing them up, crossing them out, right? Trying to solve it visually. And then he finds he's got 5 left. And 9 circles.
So I think you take the 5 times left
and put it over 50.
You
got
5 times over 50. 5 over 50? Not quite right. And they each get how much exactly? 5 pounds. And then what do we do with that? There's 5 pieces left.
Okay, so you divide the 5 left over into halves, and then what happens to them, you think? Okay, so he's then trying to figure out those 5. Okay. So given our lack of time, I'll stop there. It goes on a little bit more. But the real question here is, okay, what are you seeing here? Oops. In terms of student. What do you see in terms of student understanding or not understanding? And I know you're not upper elementary math teachers, but what might you think about? What would you do next? Or what would you have done with this thing?
He is a genius. He has patience.
That's
true.
That's great. So some of the folks in the discussion say, wow, you know, he's really persistent and thinking. And obviously, this kid is going to be a math student. He's got, but do you just let him keep going then? That's where the discussion goes. Or would you do something? What would others do? Right.
I tell him, what if I gave you, pretend somebody gave you another thing and you had 10,
mm-hmm.
What would you do then?
Right, okay.
Because 9 and 5 are kind of hard to work.
Right, so you might simplify
then
the.
Okay, I'll lend you.
Yes.
Okay, then what would you do?
Okay.
I won't take what I'll give you.
Okay,
you
good. So
okay,
you'd be.
But it's an actual rice, so we understand a pound of rice isn't like one thing that.
Right, okay, so you might go to more physical things, you might simplify the problem. This is the kind of discussion we get into. And the discussion variables, I was just looking at one of these discussions and I won't take time to show, but the one I loved is after a lot of comments and back and forth and some saying, you should have intervened earlier, or some saying, well, that was great, but I never would have sat back and watched it. I would just told them how to do it. And one of the teachers finally said, well, the difference here is whether we're teaching him to get the correct answer or to understand the mathematics. And that just triggered this ahas from a bunch of people. Because it's so hard, and even the people we have doing these interviews, when I've done it, it is so hard to sit there and not say, no, it's just 5 nights, you know, you're almost there. But that just tells them the answer. It doesn't help them develop their thinking.
But
yes.
Even if you were to get the student to the point where you get 5 nights, conceptually, what do you do with 5 nights?
right.
people. And, you know, so
yes.
I actually think the way that he approached it was much more realistic
mm-hmm.
than this arbitrary, oh, well,
yep.
Five months, and that's, you know, like, what
absolutely. The whole discussion around, you know, and obviously a lot of elementary teachers, they just kind of teach the algorithm. In fact, one of the things that when I was working on the math curriculum, it was just such one of those moments where my own insight, I went to a fifth grade classroom, and I remember the problems well. The kids were doing multiplying whole numbers by fractions. And there was a problem that said, John took 24 pictures, 2/3 of the pictures were of his cat, how many were of his cat? And I sat down with one little guy who did 24, you know, divided by 3, and came up with 8. And he forgot the second step they had taught, which is you divide by the denominator, multiply by the numerator. So I said, okay, suppose it said 1/3 of the pictures were of his cat. So he said, okay, and he drew another division sign, put in the 24, put in the 3 in, and said, it's 8. And I said, well, could 1/3 of something and 2/3 of the same thing be the same? And he looked down and he said, yeah, they're both 8. And it turned out he had no idea what a third was. He didn't know if it was bigger or smaller than a half. But if he knew how to manipulate whole numbers, if you remember the second step, he would have gotten every problem in the book right, and no one would ever notice that he had no idea what this was about. And to me, that was just this fundamental moment of we really have to think about understanding, not just algorithms. Yes, sir?
I think there's two underlying things that we want. One is that there's a concept that we're talking about. We want them to explore different ways to get to that. But on the other hand, we have to teach them the conventions by which the concept is expressed.
Yes.
So we have to teach them what is, you know, 5 remainder 5, or what is 5/9,
yep.
or 5 with a line over it in the 9, or 50 with a line over it in the 9, right? So there's all
yep.
sorts of conventional ways we express them, but they're different theoretical ways that they can get to.
Yes. And the question of where do you start and what leads, there's a tremendous number of pedagogical questions. And the point here for me is, you know, thinking in terms of professional learning, what are the activities that really engage educators in thinking together, exploring their own, this becomes an opportunity to reflect on how you teach and how you deal with the situation, to share it with your colleagues, to understand different perspectives. And it's, you know, I'm making a lot of one example, but it turned out to be a wonderful example of generating the kind of professional reflection and engagement and exchange that we find to be very beneficial. There's a couple of comments. Okay, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, I think this also gets to the heart of what are our objectives as teachers? What do
yes.
we prioritize? That
yep.
takes time. So
yep.
watch someone
that comes in.
Share
yes.
their thinking.
Yes.
Ask the questions that reveal
yep.
their thinking. When we have content
yep.
to get through,
yep.
at an end
and,
of
and too many kids.
Tests or whatever,
yes. Yes.
We don't have the time
yep.
to do
yep.
the good teaching or the
yep.
good pedagogical thing. So I think that's great.
But
you going to do that for their
right.
team?
No, and that's certainly part of it. But getting teachers sort of more attuned to kids' thinking. We understand not everybody can do these, but we do ask them, they all have a project, and we ask them in the project to pick some activities, sit down with the kid or two, do this kind of process to help the teacher's own development. It's not to say you can do this every day with 25 kids or whatever you have, but it's a lens that a lot of the elementary teachers don't have about teaching mathematics. I'm going to run out of time, so you had one more comment over here?
No, let's go.
You sure?
It's parallel to
behind you, though, in the green.
I was just saying, watch that video, maybe think a lot of experiential education.
I'm sorry, I missed the key word. In the
watching that made me think of experiential education.
Experiential, yes.
A lot of that in my background.
Yes.
I think that it's really effective to watch somebody explore
yeah.
and fail. Explore and fail, and then get it on their own.
Yes.
Okay.
So,
being committed to that, I think you will
okay. So I'm not going to get to show much of the MOOCs. I'm going to jump to the design principles. But this is a kind of example when we talk about those principles, looking for ways to bring them into actual activities. So we had lots of questions about could we build effective professional learning, how are they different from other MOOCs, other forms of online learning, et cetera. And through this work, we gradually articulated a set of design principles that we now have been doing research on. Tomorrow's one of 3 dissertations we'll have. It's kind of cool being in the university, you get a lot of free research. But I want to talk about these in the few minutes we have left. And then I know we wanted some time to get input from folks. So one of the design principles in MOOC specifically is multiple voices. You, have any of you taken MOOCs, signed up for MOOCs, and not finished them like most of us do? Yes, I did. These are not talking head MOOCs. As I said, our talking heads are not allowed to talk for more than 5 minutes. We have teacher voices. We have expert panels, which are the, you know, typically university or other folks. We have student voices. We have classroom videos. That to make sure we have multiple perspectives in all of these MOOCs is a very important design principle. A second principle is this is designed for self-directed personalized learning. I didn't get to show it, but we have core resources that are typically some articles, some videos, very carefully selected. Some are research background for those who want it. Some are classroom descriptions. That in each of those we annotate with a brief description to help people decide, is this what I want? Will this be useful to me? We ask people to then rate them so we can share back the ratings. The next time we do the course, we get rid of any that were not well rated. We hope to eventually have enough data to have like a recommendation engine, an Amazon kind of thing. You know, if you're a sixth grade teacher of special needs kids, these are the things that other special needs teachers found useful. If you're a teacher at a very sophisticated group of students, et cetera. But this idea of many different paths, and I'll show some quick data there, these are not a everybody step through. And we ask people their goals when they sign up, and our concern is that people meet their goals. We don't care if they, quote, finish the course, if they did everything. It's did they meet their own learning goals. So that's an important principle. Peer-supported learning, I mentioned we design things to foster good engaged discussion, and the example showed is one of them. We do crowdsourcing. Share the resources that you found most useful. So we gather things from the folks. We have people do projects. We do peer feedback. One of the things in MOOCs, you know, we can't review everything. So there's a peer feedback, but we do that very differently than other MOOCs. Other MOOCs, they do like random assignments of who gives feedback to who, and it's all confidential. We put that right in the discussion. So if three of you give feedback to a fourth, you know who it was, you can talk back and forth and try to build constructive learning and a critical friends kind of thing. Twitter chats I hate, but we've tried them in some MOOCs and some people love them. My policy is if consenting adults want to do Twitter, that's fine, but I'm not doing it. We'll let people do that. But so peer-supported learning is very important. Job-connected learning, action planning, case studies, projects, things to try with students. And then one of the nice things, there are both advantages and disadvantages of any modality of professional development. One of the nice things of this kind of online learning is we can spread things over time. So we can have people try something in the classroom, reflect on it, and report back. If we had a one-day thing and we didn't come back together for 6 months, it's hard to do that. So the flow of time is different in how things have to be in small chunks, but it allows you to kind of connect things up in different ways. And we try to really think through the design advantages and disadvantages of each type of modality we use. Links to blended learning, this is really important to us. We now have taken some of these MOOCs and we've wrapped a graduate course around them. So our own students, a cohort of 15 or 20 at NC State, do some introductory stuff, participate in the MOOC, and then finish up their own projects for credit. When we first proposed this idea, I got, you know, universities that's like slow to change and wonder about new ideas. They're like, what's this MOOC thing? And I finally rewrote it and said, the MOOC, it's a set of resources, so it replaces the reading package or the books, because it is. It's very rich resources. And it's field experience, because it's opportunities for our students to engage with experienced educators from around the world. And they said, oh, resources and field experience, great. And it became something we can do at NC State. We also been working with places. These MOOCs are much more powerful when a local team decides to do them together to share ideas and bring them back to schools. We now do PLC guides with them and try to foster that kind of thing. So we don't see these as an answer, but we see them as another tool in the professional learning toolbox that can really help us. I'm just going to skip along. We found that there's interest in this. This is all data from the first couple digital learning transition MOOCs. We've now had 24,000 educators register in these things. typically, as in other MOOCs, half the people who register never show up again, so down to 12,000. Half of those pop in once or twice and then go away, but it means we've had 6,000 people have real learning experiences that were of some benefit. More than 80 countries, we did nothing to advertise it internationally. People just find out and show up. Some of our most active participants were around the world, and the one person sitting in some village in Africa who somehow got connected. It's quite fascinating.
And it's all in English?
All in English. In fact, we say that this was designed for U.S. educators in U.S. schools. Others are welcome to join in. And of course, in the feedback then we always get from the international, this was too U.S.-based, but that's what it is. We've talked with some folks from UNESCO about internationalizing some of it, but we don't have the capacity to do something that's really designed that way. I won't spend time on that. A variety of people, different levels of experience. The survey results during the course and on are pretty strong. Of course, those who didn't like it drop out, so we have a biased sample. But basically, the message is we know lots of people are saying they get something from benefit of this. Some don't. Sometimes when we try to follow up, it's hard to follow up with the dropouts, but it's often just time or it wasn't the right fit. This is a graph I want to show. This is brand new. I just showed it to Tamar. We find in all our MOOCs, once we get past, we forget about those who signed up and never showed up, forget about those who popped in once or twice and never came back, those who have some engagement fall in all the MOOCs into five categories. These are confidence interviews of the range. One category are those who really are committed and are stable. The y-axis here is basically whether they looked at videos, read something, participated in discussion, had sort of four engagements during a week. So there's some, and these are the people who say from the beginning that they plan to spend a good amount of time and often want the CEUs. So there's a good number of those. This is from a Learning Differences MOOC, and 64% of those actually request a certificate for CEUs and finish the requirements. Then there's a group we call mid-rise, sometimes it goes up and down again, who start out slowly and get more and more involved. And sometimes it drops off again. So it may be that it's the middle of the course's most interest or somehow they got engaged. We never really thought about that group, but it's an interesting group. Then there's another group that start out pretty engaged, drop off, and often they come back and do something at the end. There's the slow decline who are involved at the beginning and then fade away. And there's those who are involved for the first week or two and fade away. And it's just, we're thinking about trying to get more information. Well, you know, is that a problem or is that fine? Is it that these people weren't really interested in the beginning introductory overview stuff, but there's something in the middle that they're really interested in, right? Is there something we could do to better keep these people? Are we not meeting their needs that can be met? Or are they just curious and they want to come in and see what this is about and they really never intended to complete it? I've signed up for lots of MOOCs like that. So I know I need to stop, so I will, but we have lots and lots of data. The analytics are unbelievable. We can track every click everybody makes in these things, and so we're getting into the whole big data thing. But it's really interesting to be able to have a really different lens on these kinds of things and think about how does that feedback into design and how do we use that. I've got lots more to say, but I'm out of time. We wanted to raise one final question. Do you want to do that? I think I have it on the last slide.
Thank you. Well, first of all, let's thank Glenn for coming.